I have to make a very humble start here, so it's not a clearly polished paper with a clear message that I'm going to tell you. This is sort of a crowdsourcing exercise. This is just a research project in the making. So you can jump in whenever you want. In a sense, it's also sort of a recombination of prior research streams on high growth firms, regional development, emergence of new technologies, but then in the sort of scope of what we call the platform economy or platform society. So very much inspired by the work by Martin and also Jose on how we can make sense of this new wave of institutions, technologies, organizational arrangements. We are sort of in the midst of the making, and we need to make sense of that both from a strategy point of view, but even more so from a public policy point of view. So that's what I'm aiming to do, taking my legacies with entrepreneurship studies, economic geography, industrial dynamics with me. All right, so it's titled Platform Strategies of Scale-Ups, New Articulations of the Global and the Local. What am I talking about? Well, this probably you know. So we're talking about especially new actors that drive the experimentation, development, diffusion of new technologies and how this fits into existing institutions, organizational arrangements, and also changing these institutions and organizational arrangements. We think about scale-ups, so high growth firms, let's say between 5 to 15 years, firms like Uber, founded in San Francisco 2008, not by coincidence, another firm, Airbnb, also in San Francisco, both also started in the San Francisco environment with their first market. They were driven by a venture capital model that's more or less invented in Silicon Valley. But this, of course, is not the whole story. I think that's also different than, let's say, the internet revolution. And Martin has written very nice books about that. That was, let's say, some 2 decades ago, that we now have a sort of a counter additional revolution in China with many firms that you perhaps have never used and never heard of, but these are really, let's say, competitors and also equivalents to the American firms like Xiaomi. I think it's the third largest smartphone producer of the world at the moment, but also establishing all kind of platform markets like crowdfunding platforms. Mogrije, that's founded in Hangzhou in 2011. That's sort of the counter firm to Pinterest. Luckily, we have one of these firms in the Netherlands nowadays. That's Adyen, a payment service platform. So if you make online transactions via your credit card, it's likely that this will go via the platform of Adyen. Another European example is Funding Circle, one of the most prominent crowdfunding peer-to-peer lending platforms, especially for SMEs, which has started in London in the UK, especially due to enabling financial market regulation in the UK, and now it has expanded, I think, to the US, Spain, Germany, and the Netherlands as well. These are all new platform players. These are agents that change these markets, that have experimented and have scaled up successful platform models. In venture capitalist terms, these are called unicorns. So my daughters like to play with unicorns and make unicorn fairy tales, but this is another fairy tale. These are unicorns. These are firms that are private companies, newly founded private companies that are valued $1 billion. They are still private, so the moment they go to the stock market or are acquired by other firms, like Alibaba went to the stock market a few years ago, Skype was taken over by Microsoft, so then they end being unicorns. But here are the 6 players I just mentioned, which are, I think, still unicorns. Uber, Airbnb, Funding Circle, Adyen, Xiaomi, Mooji. You can see this is a highly uneven, skewed distribution over the globe. So this is the Fortune list. We have about 4 lists of these unicorns, which partly overlap. 170 firms at the moment. You can say, well, this is a global game. But if you look at it from a distance, there are South America, Africa, Australia are really off the map. I think there's one a unicorn in Brazil. If California would be a country, that would really be massively dominating this game. So you have the US, some European countries, some smaller countries like Israel, the United Arab Emirates, Singapore. By the way, this is unicorns per 10 million inhabitants, so we control for country size here. China, but China is well, if you visit China, it's not one country. This is really just three city regions. So it's Beijing, Shanghai, and the Hangzhou area, which those unicorns are concentrated. So it's a highly uneven skewed distribution. So if you think that these platforms are sort of a global phenomenon, could be started anywhere, well, dream on, perhaps in theory, but even in theory, which we'll go further in depth in the coming slides, there are only a few places which are the cradle of these kind of platform-based firms. And if you think they are of global reach, that's also nonsense, because especially the whole set of unicorns in China are established because a lot of these, let's say, Facebook, WhatsApp is not allowed in China. So institutional regulations also create space for other alternatives. And well, there's a nice article by my colleagues Sibyl Uzunka and Koen Richtering on the spread of urban Airbnb in the UK, the Netherlands and Egypt. And then you also learn that there are very fine grade institutional conditions that enable or constrain the diffusion of these technologies. So they're very sensitive to institutions, in contrast to what the technophiles are going to make us believe, that these are sort of a global phenomenon that spread on a carpet around the world. That's not true. There's a very strict interaction of institutions and technology. So, and if you, being a geographer, you, and I already pushed a bit on this is not a country game, it's very much a city-region game. This is the number of unicorns per city. By the way, not all unicorns are platform-based, but many of these unicorns are platform-based. Why is this so? Because a platform is a strategy to gain world dominance, at least in the eyes of entrepreneurs and venture capitalists. This is a way to gain world dominance, and you need to subsidize the early users of the network to reach network economies, which means that you, if you don't have retained profits, you need a lot of venture capital, which brings you into this game of unicorns. So it's not a one-to-one translation, but there's a huge overlap between the rise of dominant new platform players and this unicorn list. You can see, yeah, it is a Silicon Valley game still, but number two is already Beijing, China. Shanghai is also with seven. You probably have never heard of Hangzhou, China, but that's really one of the third spot of Alibaba has been growing there, and also several others. It's just a city of 9 million, which is half of the Netherlands, and the Netherlands is only one unicorn. So you, if you would transpose this to the Netherlands, you would have 8 unicorns in the Netherlands, and I think the Dutch government would really herald this in any way. So that's really highly skewed. And if you can also, if you would take Mountain View, Redwood, Palo Alto also as one region, then it would even be more skewed. So on the one hand, it's skewed.
So on unicorns.
Yeah.
So when you go to the stock market or you acquire,
then you are public and not a private company anymore.
But why isn't it interesting to if you're interested in startups, why not take them into account if you want to understand where the fast-growing firms are?
Well, this is a phase. So the ultimate idea about entrepreneurship is that we look at emergence of novelty. And this unicorn is about the emergence of substantial novelty, so with a high impact. So this list is used to trace substantial impact and substantial promise of new technologies. And once it is stock listed and or is taken over, it's sort of merged in established structures,
okay.
You can say.
Right.
So it's a transitionary process that we would like to capture, so to say. It's not perfect, and I would also like to hear your comments about alternatives. I think this is one of the least worst ways to measure this. But of course, then,
I'm just finishing a paper that discusses this particular moment. This unicorn phenomenon is part of a kind of a hype of the moment. It's almost like the 2000 bubble.
Yep.
And the amount of capital that's now available to value these firms, some of which don't have business.
It's a sort of a self-reinforcing hype model in a sense.
Yeah, it's
objectifying financial value that is still highly uncertain.
You need to be worth a billion, more than a billion, to signal
to get more attention.
Yeah. And it's part of also winning a platform sector, right?
Yeah.
You've got the billion.
It's sort of
and
intricated.
She doesn't have the billion,
yeah.
You will win.
Yeah.
Generally speaking.
Yeah.
So that's why it's used so much today.
Yeah, being partly an economic geographer, I just can't lose my spatial glasses. So that's, so what, why study this? Well, I think these are new kind of organizations that have the promise to be global, born global, immediately have global presence. On the other hand, you see that it's a highly localized birthing phenomenon, so to say. So I think we need to improve our understanding of spatial organization of platform-based scale-ups, because these are really different animals, I would say, than the internet, the oil, the railroad revolutions. On the other hand, they are developing a new infrastructure, enabling new economic interactions and new social interactions, like the previous revolutions did as well, but there are some differences. More in general terms, if you are interested in the platform society or the platform economy, you would like to know what is driving this in a bottom-up fashion. And I think then understanding these unicorns is a very interesting way to start to think about how a micro-based interaction leads to meso-macro structures. So these are the agents of change in the emerging of a platform economy. And if you're a Schumpeterian economist, you would think, well, okay, this is just creative destruction, isn't it? And we've had libraries written full about that. Yeah, I think some of the mechanisms might be generalized, but I think some of the network effects and specific elements of the platform technologies make it a slightly different story, which we still don't fully comprehend. And also, for example, the competition or antitrust authorities do not fully grasp. The venture capitalists themselves even do not fully comprehend. So I think we need more about this to make sure that we are ending up in a society that is for the greater good of us all in the coming 10 to 20 years. And then a more specific research question is, which I'm just going to pose, I'm not going to answer, my apologies for that. To what extent and how do platform-based strategies of scale-ups make them independent or dependent on their home region? Because that's an interesting question for local economic and national economic development policymakers, but also for labor unions, because this labor is also getting, let's say, more footloose or less attached to particular national or regional institutional regimes. It's interesting for product market regulation, for example, if you think about crowdfunding. It's interesting for taxation, so what is really the home base of these kind of firms, and how can we make them pay for the public good, so to say. Etc. So I think this is not just an innocuous question. I think it has a lot of implications, and that's also what I like about this workshop and this thinking about the platform society. It's really being forced to rethink our existing theories and understandings of how the world works, so to say. Of course, there will be mechanisms that will still be relevant, but their relative weight will be different. Well, to start with the platform strategy, my definition, which is also much in line with Jose's and Martin's and some others, is that it's a digital infrastructure. So it's not just an infrastructure, but a digital infrastructure that enables two or more groups to interact. If you take somewhat more economistic interpretation, then it's about the matching of supply and demand or users and consumers. I refrain from taking the product family platform definition. Hans is already gone, but he's sort of more in depth. Well, I would say camp, but he thinks more about, let's say, Intel, gaming, Internet of Things, which is a platform technology, I would say, which might enable the interaction of groups, but not necessarily so. And it's not about organizational platforms, which are sort of collections of resources and capabilities. Then a platform strategy is about creating and capturing value, just like any strategy, but by enabling platform participants to benefit from the presence of others. And then we get the whole story about how to build up network externalities, how to build up a presence and a dominance so that your network is valuable to all the participants, which is a very, in a sense, this is sort of industrial organizations 2.0, because in the old days, when you started a mining company, you had a lot of initial investments to make to reach minimum efficient scale. Well, it's not these platform strategies are not about minimum efficient scale, but they are probably about minimum efficient size of the network, so to say, which you need a lot of investments to make. So it's not an easy game to play. And also there's a lot of governance issues taking place with technological development. And then the real question is how for platform entrepreneurs or managers, how can they build up such a platform and not only create value for all the participants, but also take their fair or unfair share of the pie to exist as a value-generating orchestrator. The question is, well, how is this different from normal, I would almost say, brick-and-mortar companies? Well, the sort of the workhorse model in strategic management economics of the firm is the resource-based view or the dynamic capabilities view of the firm, which is the assumption that if firms have resources that are valuable, rare, hard to imitate or not to substitute, that deliver sustainable competitive advantage. But that is very much based on an internal looking view on the firm. So these are resources, assets that are owned and internal to the firm. And I think this whole platform strategy adds a new dimension of in combination with the external network. And if you, of course, you need to have internal assets to make this network work, you need to have digital nerds, human capital to develop such a network. But if you're not going to orchestrate and build the external network and the external asset, it will not work as a platform strategy. So it doesn't mean that the internal assets are going to be redundant, but it's a more complicated game in the sense that you also need to build up an external presence and an external network with the technologies and organizational arrangements that go hand. In that sense, it's getting harder to build a sustainable competitive advantage. But the prize ultimately will be a winner take all, or at least a winner take a few winners that take most of the market. But there will be a lot of churning and a lot of lots of resources in the meantime. For scale-ups, this is a model or the platforms enable the startups to grow quickly, but you need to subsidize the use of initial users. So, and especially if you don't have retained earnings, there's no way that you can finance it. So it will only work to establish this network dominance with external funding. So that's why this overlap of this unicorn list with this platform challenges is so interesting.
So I think Cohen had a question and then I have one.
Well, I signaled 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes, okay. So you know, what's so interesting from my perspective is how inexpensive it is to get a platform going.
The first beta, yeah.
The open source software, the ability to use AWS, Amazon Web Services, to do all of your computing, makes this so inexpensive to enter, and you can get venture capital. $1 million is not hard to get in, neither in Silicon Valley or here in, it's not Amsterdam, but you probably go for $1 million, you'd go to Amsterdam. And then to win, how
extremely
much capital is needed. So to enter is almost, it's less than almost any other industry ever in the tech. However, to win takes so much capital. And I think that's the very interesting. So you have so many experiments today. And I'll give in my slides, I'll give you some examples of how many experiments you can have. Not saying there'll be winners, but experiments. And so that's what makes this, I think, fascinating for us social scientists.
Yeah. So society as a lab is becoming more relevant, so to say, because there's a huge amount of experimentation going on. Although viable experiments, that is another story again.
But viable, you see viable once it starts to get
traction. Yeah.
So that's what the VCs look for. You're getting users, you've got a curve like that, then I give you 5 million and build you. But it's that experimentation and then adoption.
Yeah. So one of the big question is, can we better distinguish the ability for experimentation in particular firms, societies, and the ability to scale up, which seem to be a completely different ballgame, but you need first experimentation to come to a viable solution. The interesting thing is, I think that countries like the Netherlands are pretty good in experimenting, but not in scaling up. And China is perhaps not that good in experimenting, but very good in scaling up. And how can we better understand this perhaps global division of labor, also with the role of venture capital?
But just to add to this, then if this is the crucial challenge, then you can expect that in the future most platforms will come from incumbents that can already leverage their network, and Amazon and all these platforms are entering.
Well, not in the experimentation.
The question is, why don't they do it so little? You could say, for some reason they don't want to bother their existing users with many new services, or maybe they feel constrained in diversification, but they don't have the problem of funding scale because they can leverage their existing scale.
So a lot of interesting, I think, components to this. The other interesting component is you buy it, Instagram, WhatsApp, YouTube. Now, these are names that you may have heard of. And they were this big when they were bought, and, you know, and then the firm comes in. So they see that curve, and the firm comes in and takes them on, which is antitrust implication that we haven't talked to. And so that's, I think, experimentation, and then this
scaling,
plucking, creating interesting new dynamics.
Yeah. Yeah, with two completely different sets of conditions enabling those two phenomena. Well, and they are, as I already said, they are very sensitive to institutional conditions. If you think about crowdfunding, very sensitive to financial regulation, transportation being very sensitive to existing regulation. And this is something that is forgotten about, which is interesting for economic geographers and social scientists alike, how this interacts, this technology and institutions, and especially on the national scale, but also on the regional and the local scale, because, well, I'm not going to talk about sharing economy, but there are quite some cities that are experimenting with regulation at the local scale to make this possible. And then there's, as you could expect from me, I'm going to talk about ecosystems. Then there's this implicit assumption that platform strategies are also ecosystem strategies, and then we enter a whole terminological soup with ecosystems, which I'm still trying to make sense of. But I sort of distinguish two main types of literatures. This is the business ecosystem literature, which is, according to Ron Adner, one of the leading scholars, the alignment structure of the multilateral set of partners that need to interact in order for a focal value proposition to materialize. There's no spatial dimension to this. It's just a story that if you want to be successful, especially as a platform, you need to develop communities or ecosystems on the user and the producer side. And that's this external component that you need to take care of, that you need to govern, and that you need to align, which brings all kind of new strategic questions along. And then my own interpretation, the entrepreneurial ecosystem, a set of interdependent actors and factors coordinated in such a way that they enable productive entrepreneurship within a particular territory. There's a very they both share the interaction and interdependence, which goes back to the natural ecosystem, so to say, and the artificial ecosystem literature from Herbert Simon, etc. But here the focus is on how entrepreneurship is enabled in a particular territory, which is an age-old question in economic geography, economic development studies. But the nice thing is that on the one hand, you have this business ecosystem, which is implicitly global, and you have the entrepreneurial ecosystem, which is very explicitly local. And they seem to be both very relevant because of the interdependence of this platform business model. But how they work out and what their relative weight is, that's really the big question for me for the coming years to take care of, which is of interest for both economic policy, but also for competition policy, for antitrust, for product market regulation, for taxation, for thinking about how to stimulate this new platform society, the new technological, institutional, organizational arrangements that have the promise to make our lives better, but probably not in the best way that we can think of, and not in the most open and accessible way that is in the, interest of the key players in this new, brave new world of the platform society. How are we going to approach this? I think both a case study approach, compare and contrast a set of platform-based scale-ups in three continents, because I think understanding the three continents is very essential here. In somewhat similar types of business lines, so digital payments, crowdfunding, transportation, because they have to face different types of regulations. And thinking about contrasting what I've done in my previous work, platform-based scale-ups that have stayed in the region of origin and that left the region of origin, but I can at the moment only think of Skype that explicitly left Stockholm for Luxembourg, but mainly for taxation reasons. So the question is, what is a headquarter is also a sort of an ontological question now, to ultimately answer the question to what extent and how do platform-based strategies of scale-ups make them independent on the home region. And we're also going to scrape all these lists and we're also currently doing this, of unicorns, and try to explain with all the data that's available how we can better explain the unequal rise of these platforms around city regions in the world. So we're going to look at city regions, not countries. Okay. Thank you. Thanks.